exciting. I love weddings. I've gotten the chance over the last couple of months to do a couple of them. We got some pictures, actually, of, I think, somewhere. There we go. Yeah, that one just happened. These guys right there, that was really awesome. And so I got a chance to do that wedding right over in, like, this barn thing, which was legit. It was just really cool. So I got to do that one. Got to do another one down on the beach not long ago. That was really cool. And so we got, it was my first ever wedding selfie. And so that was really awesome with Matt and Chelsea. I don't know what the picture in the top right's really about, to be honest with you guys. So I always start off when you're talking about when I'm doing a wedding, just telling them that my favorite thing about the wedding is that God is this hopeless romantic. He calls us his treasured possession, and all of the story of Scripture is about God relentlessly chasing us down. And so we're going to be starting into this series called Love Song. And we're going to be in the book of Song of Solomon. And if you've ever read that book at all, this is clearly a PG-13 series that we are going to be in, as we're going to talk about some stuff. And as we talk about it, I know a lot of folks go, why do we spend time talking about this? Like, it's one of those subjects that church tends to avoid. And so I have a couple answers for you. Number one, back in October of last year, our leadership team got together. We said, what is a big focus that we feel like God is pushing us towards in 2016? And that big focus for 2016 was family, marriage. And I got to tell you, over the last year, I have counseled a ton of them. And there are still several that I'm counseling, and we've seen people get married, we've seen people go through struggles, and it's just very apparent that God needs us to focus on this at this time. It's an important issue. And so I also don't back away from talking about things like sex, and the reason I don't is because I don't know that there's anything that is more damaging or pervasive in our culture that pushes us into a life of sin and distrust and godlessness than that, and yet the church, more often than not, stays silent. And I don't believe the Bible wants us to do that. There's an entire book of Scripture dedicated to the beauty of this image. And so we're going to talk about it. And so it's going to be, today may get really interesting for some of you, okay? And so I want you to dive in with me. We're going to be looking in just a minute in Song of Solomon, starting in chapter 3. Now, let me set this up for you. In the 1950s, there was a book that came out called The Lord of the Flies. How many of you guys had to read that in school or read it somewhere else? Okay. So The Lord of the Flies is essentially about a group of 13-year-olds that were all abandoned on this island, and this island was paradise. It was beautiful. It was amazing. It had everything they needed, but they're 13-year-olds, and they had no idea what to do with paradise. And so being placed in paradise without any instruction, without any authority, they almost wreck the entire thing and burn it to the ground until a naval officer shows up, and he brings authority into their life. And they start to see how far they've strayed. And they realize real quickly that we've gotten off track and we didn't have anybody to tell us how far we drifted. And sex is a lot like that. In Song of Solomon, the woman in Song of Solomon will call her body paradise. And it's amazing to me how quickly we can drift and burn paradise to the ground. I mean, it's so beautiful when you think about how God looks at sex and marriage and intimacy. I mean, from the very beginning, I mean, Adam is the guy who is rolling around going, cow, bird. And he's like naming things like hippopotamus. Like, he's doing that, and this guy doesn't have a real great vocabulary. He's just making up sounds. And then when the woman shows up, he, for the first time, this guy who is not eloquent just goes into poetry. He sees her. He says, I am Ish. She is Isha. He says, I am man. She is, whoa, man. He jumps right into poetry. And it's awesome and it's beautiful. But when we don't handle paradise well, we can burn it to the ground and hurt the people in it. So the world is going to give us a particular perspective about things like sex and intimacy. If you watch enough movies, here's what we know is always true. All guys have six-pack abs. Every woman looks great in a bikini. To get a woman going, all you have to do is go, how you doing? And to get a man going, all you got to do is show up. That one's actually probably accurate. No one ever has morning breath, and no one ever says, ouch, you're pulling my hair. Like, that never happens in the movies. We get a lot of our depiction of love from these incredible love songs. And so I want you to do me a favor. If you got your phone right now and you're a Facebook person, I want you to pull your phone out. If you have a smartphone, and I want you to get on Facebook, the last thing I posted was this little red image of a cassette tape and a heart. I'm going to play for you some songs. Now, as I play these songs that have kind of given us, so many of us over the years, this great deal of passion and love, and really kind of anchors us to what the world talks about in love, first of all, if you know the song I'm playing, just sing along for a minute. Have a good time. Okay, Wes? All right, so I didn't put Wes's in there. Wes is amazed by Lone Star, along with Chris Roebuck. So pray for them. And here's the other thing I want you to do, and I posted this on Facebook. If you go, man, I'm listening the whole time, and the song I thought should be there isn't there, I want you to go to that feed, and I want you to be like, oh, Jason, you missed this one, okay? So who knows what might happen if you do that. Just trust me. It might come in later in the series. So give me a favor. This is about 3 minutes, and if you know any of them, you can sing. If you're not a singer, you can just go, yeah, like when the one that you like comes on. Come on. We had no yes on that one. Just a few teenage boys began dancing. That's it. And Jeff. And Laura. All the kids of the 80s are excited right now. Lord of the Flies, we need an authority that helps us navigate well this life of love and sex. And so today we're going to look at a couple, and we're going to join them at their wedding ceremony and then their wedding night. And we are going to look at what that is like. And then we are going to turn the sprinklers on here because it's going to be hot. Okay? Like, it's going to be intense. We get to see this couple on their wedding night, and love and intimacy will be a source of life and a source of joy. And God is going to amen me all the way through this message. It's going to be awesome. So here we go. Chapter 3, if you got that, can you please put that up there? It says this, starting in chapter 3, verse 6, it says, "Who is this sweeping in from the wilderness like a cloud of smoke? Who is this fragrant with myrrh and frankincense and every kind of spice? It is Solomon's carriage surrounded by 60 heroic men, the best of Israel's soldiers. They are skilled swordsmen, experienced warriors. Each one wears a sword on his thigh, ready to defend the king against an attack in the night. King Solomon's carriage is built of wood imported from Lebanon. Its posts are silver. Its canopy is gold. Its cushions are purple. It was decorated with love by young women of Jerusalem. Come out and seek King Solomon, young women of Jerusalem. He wears the crown his mother gave him on his wedding day, his most joyous day." And so this is her speaking. This is at the ceremony. And this is some things that we're going to get as she speaks about how she feels about the man that she loves. And the first one, we get in verse 6 when it says that it is sweeping in from the wilderness like a cloud of smoke. Like a pillar of smoke is what it's really talking about. She's saying as he comes in, the only other time that this reference is used in Scripture is if you go back when the Israelites are wandering after they've been released from Egypt, and they're wandering through the wilderness, and God appears to them as a pillar of smoke and a pillar of fire, and that pillar of smoke is there as protection for them. He says, there's this holy moment where I fall under the protection of my God, and as I see this man coming in, this man is holy. He is there to protect me under God. He is there to comfort me and to nurture me under God. And it says, who is this fragrant with myrrh and frankincense and every kind of spice? It's a beautiful thing. If you don't know this about the old days, now you guys are one slide behind, just so you know. So the beautiful thing that you get right here as he looks at this is that this guy he's giving them this image. In the Old Testament, they had a particular set of spices that they would mix in the temple. It was the only place that was allowed to be used. It was a fragrance that existed in the temple so that when you walked into the temple, you had this sweet smell of God. And it was designed as you walked in there. Like if you ever hear in the Old Testament, it said, we're going to pour out a fragrant offering before God. We're going to pour out this offering of fragrance and incense. It is the smell of God, a sweet smell to bring this feeling that when you smell it, you just are reminded of the presence of God. And so she says, he's a pillar over me of protection of my spiritual life, and he smells of God. He reeks of the Savior. And I love that. She starts out with, he is holy. But then she moves on. It's Solomon's carriage surrounded by 60 heroic men, the best of Israel's soldiers. And then she starts talking about their experienced warriors, and they carry a sword. He's not only holy, but he is safe. She says, listen, in the old days, there were always 30 men that were the secret service. They were the special forces of the king. It was always 30. There were 30, incredible men who guarded the king at all times. And when this guy comes in, he comes in with 60, twice the amount. 30 for me, 30 from you, to protect you, that there is safety with me. Women, and listen, I know some of these statements will be somewhat generalizing, but overall, we know that one of the greatest desires in a woman is for comfort and security. I was watching, a buddy of mine sent me a thing on Facebook of this wedding. A friend that we knew is in Special Forces, and he had gotten married. Well, while these guys were all deployed overseas, they all decided to buy Harleys together. And so they come back, and for the wedding, like, it was really cool. Like, she comes out of the church, and she's jumping into a limo, and the only other vehicles surrounding it, the entire party of groomsmen, and it was a ton of them, were just flanked by Harley Davidsons. and you see this incredible smile on this woman's face as she gets in and gets out of the limo, and it's so cool. I mean, there's this thundering roar of these bikes, and I just thought, here's what made me think of when I looked at that moment. I said, she is the safest woman on the globe right there. Like, even the police are like, hey, guys, nice bikes. You know, like they're just, like, being polite. I mean, these guys are, like, they're rolling. They're going, we've got her. And that's what this was like. He's safe. She's safe. So I get couples all the time that come to me and go, we're in love. We totally get what it's like. We're basically already married. No, you're not. No, you're not. Do you know what indicates that you're married? It's not even just the exchange of love. People can exchange love and not be married. It's certainly not the exchange of physicality. Do you know what really sets you apart in a marriage? Is that when you stand before God and her daddy and you make a covenant that you will care for her heart, her body, her mind, her spirit, and you say, I will protect everything about her. You pay the bills. That's how you know. Number 9, or verse 9 and 10, he goes on to say this after it says all that, that King Solomon's carriage is built of wood imported from Lebanon. Its posts are silver, its canopies gold, its cushions are purple. It was decorated with love by the young women of Jerusalem. I love that right there. She's going, this guy, he plans. Ladies, if he doesn't plan for you, don't plan for him. Because if he loves you, he's going to step out and start to make some plans. Love prompts you to secure a future. It always does. You look at, I mean, I can't even begin to tell you the value of what he has put in. It has taken years of preparation for him to prepare this wedding. Just the purple seat itself. There is, and I had to do some really weird research here, but the purple dye that was made in that time was made up, it was made of mollusks. It took 8,000 of these mollusks being crushed to render 1 gram of that purple dye. 1 gram. This guy's put some work in. He's put some planning in. We value what we plan for. There are a lot of guys that go, man, I can't think of any time to really spend coming up with a romantic date for my wife. But you've spent weeks preparing for fantasy football season. Don't tell me you can't. We plan for what we value. I remember when I was going to marry Crystal, like I had this moment where we were in school, still trying to finish college on like year 12 or something like that. It was like we were on the long extended girl, you know, plan, and I remember getting hit by this moment of going, I gotta marry her. And so I started to do the work. I started asking my friends, like, do you think she's right for me? Like, yeah, I think she's right for you. I'm like, are you sure? Yeah, do you think I'm ready for this? Yeah, no, but go for it anyway. And so I'm like, yeah. And so I'm like, I got to do this. And so I started looking at my bank, and I'm like looking at my bank account. I'm like, I got dozens of dollars. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, like, we can do this. At that time, you know, I wasn't looking for, like, can I make it through a year? Like, that wasn't on my mind. I'm like, I thought if you were wealthy, if you could get through the next few days. And so I was like, I got dozens of bucks in here. I'm like, this is going to be awesome. So I started researching rings. Like, all my other friends are, like, researching things for, like, college classes. And I'm like, hey, do you know what a princess cut diamond looks like? And I mean, like I'm putting the research in. And then I couldn't wait to ask her. And so I was ironing one day, and I stopped ironing, and I hit a knee. And the moment I hit the knee, all these things had been planned for. I'd checked the money. I'd gone to her father. I'd done all these things. And here in this moment, with all this preparation, I said, hey, I'm wanting to prepare a life for us. Will you do this with me? I planned for it. It's even echoed in Scripture. When Jesus says, and he's talking about leaving us as his people, he says, I go to prepare a place for you. Do you know that was in Jewish custom? That was what the when they got engaged, the man in that relationship would look at his fiance and say, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I'm going to go ahead of you. Before we get married, I'm going to prepare a life for us together. And then I'll come and take care of it. That's what this looks like. He's holy. He's safe. He plans. And then I love her response in verse 11. She says this, come out and see King Solomon, young women of Jerusalem. He's like, ladies. I mean, this is how she's like. She's like, girls, check him out. Look, don't touch. He's mine. But look at this guy. He is holy. He planned for me. He is the prize. I value this godly man. He wears a crown of his mother that she gave him at his wedding. tell you what happened on the wedding night. This is going to be great. I mean, she's been dreaming her whole life of a wedding. He's dreaming about something else. Okay, like it's his moment, and he is ready to talk about it. And so the world stops. Today of seeing that woman, that man that you love, and you go, oh, wow, baby. Whoa. That's what this is. Beautiful beyond words. Your eyes are like doves behind your veil, and your hair falling waves like a flock of goats winding down the slopes of the field. Your teeth are as white as sheep, recently shorn and freshly washed. Your smile is flawless, and each tooth matches. Guys, we are task-oriented, okay? That's how men are wired. We are task-oriented. We get up in the morning. We don't think about anything. We don't think about talking or whatever. Like, I got to make breakfast. I got to make the coffee. I got to get my stuff together. I got to get dressed. I got to get out for work. I'm going to go to work. I'm going to come home. We're going to eat dinner. Sweetie, we'll have sex. 0800. That's how this rolls. It's like it's planned. It's scheduled. Women, however, are not task-oriented. They want relationship and emotional intimacy. The most erotic place on a woman's body is her mind. So start early, gentlemen. You help her. You go fill her car up with gas. You help make dinner. Write a poem. Find some words. Find them. I'm going to tell you that I believe this firmly. I don't believe that divorce in most marriages starts with the attraction to someone else. I believe it starts with the right words. Stop being sad. Men struggle to express their feelings. And guys, we may sacrifice our relationship to do it. So find the words. And ladies, when they do, don't laugh at them. They may come off goofy. It may be silly. Whatever it is, don't laugh. You will embarrass that guy. And there is not a moment in his life that he feels more fragile than in that moment. If you mock it, it will never come back. And so, they're going to give us some incredible truths. And the first one is, great sex starts early. You get up early in the morning and you begin to talk and begin to speak words of life into each other. But the second one is this. Great sex is tender. He says this in chapter 4, verse 5. Your two breasts are like two fawns, twin fawns of a gazelle that browse among the lilies. I love how one commentator said it. This commentator goes into great explanation of all the other stuff in this, and I'm going to get into that in a minute. But when it comes to her breasts, he says this. Moving down her body, he next focused on her breasts, objects of male interest, which need no explanation. No, man. I mean, he has sat there and he has said, your eyes are like doves. They are gentle. Your hair is like a flock of goats descending from Mount Gilead. That might need a little explanation. Okay, so if some of you guys are like, I don't know how to use that line correctly, Jason. So he's saying that Gilead was for them, it was the promised land. It was the most beautiful place they'd ever seen. When they crossed over into the promised land, two of the tribes of Israel said, that is where we'll make our home. These were sheep herding groups of people that we're talking to and are part of these people. It was mountainous, it was lush, it was green, it was And she was swept up in it because she's not smart. He's like, he said, your teeth are like a flock of sheep just shorn coming up from the washing. Each has its twin. So he's starting up going, your teeth, baby, they're straight, they're clean, and they're present. And that wasn't a normal thing back then. It was awesome. He said, your lips are scarlet ribbon. Your mouth is lovely. Your temples are your cheeks behind your veil. She's still wearing her clothes. They're red and amazing. And then as he moves in to her breasts, he's saying all these beautiful things, and then he gets to her breasts. So listen, despite what the commentator says, they need no explanation. I disagree. Women, and I am admittedly handicapped here, but here's what women want. Women want men. They want for us to be committed to them with your eyes, your mind, your heart. That's what they want. If it's going to be tender, it must be this. He says, you're like twin fawns of the gazelle. He says, if you're approaching those animals in the wild, it is. Okay? It's gentle. You don't run up and go, fawns! That doesn't happen. It's tender and it's gentle, and she wants to know that you're going to be tender and gentle. By the way, that was me going for a fawn, just to be clear. All right, so now women want that. Men want sex, lots of it, like that, and that doesn't make him broken. That makes him committed to Scripture, because he wants to know that she wants him, and it ignites a passion in him, and it ignites his manhood. I found this quote. This really has nothing to do with the message, but I thought it was really funny. It said, "If women had men's sex drive, we'd never get any work done, because we'd be busy having sex all the time." If men had women's sex drives, we'd get a lot accomplished, but there'd only be 300 people on the planet. I just thought that was a really funny quote. All right, so men use romance to get sex. Women use sex to get romance. It's okay that cycle exists. It was designed to exist. It's tender and it's fun, and you can go as so far as that it is safe, and she is never demeaned. And if she's not ready and she says no, we respect the no, and it's tender. We don't force anything. It is tender. If you've got some energy you need to expel, go do some working out. Release some energy. She is a child of God, a sister, and a bride. She is not a collection of parts to be abused. Be gentle. It was just beautiful. So he's moving south. He went from her eyes, and now he's reached her breast, and he's going to get to this. In verse 6, he stops, and this is where we get into this great sex, this passion. He says, until the day breaks and shadows flee, I will go to the mountain of myrrh and the hill of incense. He's been describing her. He gets down to her breasts, and he just starts singing a song.
All night long, all night.
Hey, Wes.
All night long.
And listen, he says, I'm going to go to the mountain of myrrh and the hill of incense. Those are not places in Israel, okay? That's not geography. If you go to Israel right now today and be like, can we go to the mountain of myrrh? Not with you. That's going to happen. The mountain of myrrh and the hill of incense, she is fragrant with spices. He's going to places on her. It is passionate. He is excited. He's supposed to be excited. This is the Bible, y'all. If you're visiting with us this morning, welcome to Crossroads. This is awesome. The next thing we learn. learn is that great sex is built on absolute trust. In verse 7 through 8, he says, "How beautiful you are, my darling. There is no flaw." That word for lack of flaw is the same thing that they use to describe the lamb of that is used in sacrifice. You bring the pure and the best lamb as an offering to God. And he says, "When I look at you," now we know if you read the first two chapters of Song of Solomon, she doesn't find herself without flaw. She doesn't feel good about her body, her skin. But he starts off going, "There's no flaw in you." He says, "Come with me from Lebanon, my bride. Come with me from Lebanon. Descend to the crest of Anan and to the top of Senir, to the summit." Listen, guys, every woman on some level feels an insecurity about her body, so you be careful before you ever comment or critique her about it, because you will shut down intimacy forever. What happens here, when he says, "You're perfect," and then he goes, it's like you're in Lebanon, and he goes, "You're far away. You're too far from me. I want you to come closer." And so here's what this really says. If you were to sum up these two verses, he would say, she drops her clothes. And he looks at her and he goes, "You are perfect. And too far away. Come here now. Like it's come to daddy." Like right there is that moment. It's beautiful. The next thing you learn, and this is weird to say in church, but great sex is hot. Verses 9 through 11, he says, he's still talking to her. "You have stolen my heart, my sister, my bride. You have stolen my heart with glance from your eyes. With one jewel of your necklace." He's saying, just looking at your eyes makes my heart race. A speck of your jewelry just sends me into a flutter. "How delightful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much more pleasing is your love than wine, and the fragrance of your perfume than any spice. Your lip drops sweetness as the honeycomb, my bride. Milk and honey are under your tongue." Listen, women are the pinnacle of creation in Scripture. They are the crown jewel on the top of everything that God created. And if you want to see, it's still that way today. If you want to sell magazines to a woman, you know what you put on the cover? A woman. If you just want to sell magazines to a dude, you know what you put on the cover? A woman. Because listen, no one wants to see that dude on the front. Like, no one cares. She is beautiful and amazing. It's what sent Adam into poetry the moment he saw her. I remember when Crystal and I got married, there were some people that, and I don't know how you're going to feel about this, I'm just going to be honest with you, there's some people that gave her gifts of like this little lingerie stuff. Now, my wife and I were, we were those people that you hear about that are weird. We've never been with anyone else. Yeah, we screwed it up, I know. We missed so many experiences, and I would do it again that same way if I had the chance, because it's awesome. But I remember when we were getting married, some people were like, "Oh, we're going to give her some lingerie." And I didn't even know how to say that word at the time. And that was when you're like in that place in life where when you see Victoria's Secrets, you just get nervous and giddy, and you're just like in this weird place. But they gave her some lingerie, and after we got married, I just wanted to send each of them a thank you note and just be like, "You're the best. Thank you so much." It was beautiful and awesome. She moves towards him, and his heart pounds. Let me tell you something, man. No matter what day it is, no matter what I'm dealing with, Crystal is the best thing I see every day. No matter what. Ladies, don't be ashamed with your husband. Modesty is great in public. I'll stop there. He says, "The promised land is under your tongue," in that verse. That was weird to me. I was like, what under your tongue? Like, what kind of a kiss is that? That's not even a French kiss. That's a Hebrew kiss. It's weird. Listen, in that kiss is so passionate. Do you know that kiss, I wish more people, I know this sounds very prudish, but I wish more people would wait for even that kind of a kiss until the wedding night. You know why? Because the Bible is going to tell us that kind of a kiss is designed to go somewhere. It's designed to take you to sex. And so when you do it before you can go there, it does nothing but create frustration and eventually lust and sadness. Great sex, if you hold on to it, it looks like this. The other one, great sex is holy. He says, "You're a garden locked up." He's looking at her body and going, this is a garden of delight. It is a place of paradise. You know what he's saying there? She's a virgin. And her paradise is undisturbed. He says, my sister, my bride, you are a spring enclosed, a sealed fountain. Your plants and your orchard of pomegranates with choice fruits, all of the finest spices. For most people, this verse at this point, that is the verse that creates a feeling of disappointment. You feel a sense of loss. It's because you've lost. The night for some of us that was supposed to be a glorious introduction was business as usual. And so something was missing. Like I said, Crystal and I were such losers. And yet we waited on it. God's big worry isn't pregnancy or kids. God's big worry is what it does to your soul. Satan wants to reduce sex from an intimate spiritual connection to just a physical act. In doing so, you miss everything sex was supposed to be. God knows that sexual sin hurts our soul. He knows that we'll struggle to forget, even though God will forgive. In the book of Hosea, there's this great image of a man who married a woman, and this woman is not good. As a matter of fact, she is a prostitute who sleeps with half the guys in the town. And God says to Hosea, I still want you to stay married to her. And he says, I want you to do it so that everyone will understand who God is. And Hosea takes her to the wilderness. He takes her to the place where they first met. And he speaks tenderly to her. And he woos her back. And he romances her. And it's an image of God telling us that he'll take our deepest shame and he'll make it a doorway of hope. That's the gospel. That no one in here is beyond hope. That Jesus can restore anyone from anywhere and give you a new life. This story that we're reading is the standard for us. It is what we should strive for. But when we don't hit that mark, there is still grace for when we fail. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away and the new has come. Isaiah 1:18 says, though our sins may be as crimson, God has washed them white as snow. So even if you go, man, I have disappointment that I don't have that moment, you can begin now engaging in purity and commitment to the marriage you will have or the marriage you do have. And God can begin to restore. The man in Song of Solomon is gentle and he compliments and then he waits. And she speaks again. And here's where it gets good. Verse 16. She says, awake, north wind, and come, south wind, blow on my garden that its fragrance may spread everywhere. Let my beloved come into the garden and taste its choice fruits. That is the most sensual verse in Scripture. If you're married, you should highlight this and commit it to memory. It is awesome. There are two times before this in the text where she says and he says, do not arouse or awaken love until it is so desired. Do not arouse or awaken love until, like, don't wake this thing until it's ready. Don't wake this thing until it's ready. And then you get to this verse and she says, awake. Here it is. And I love that. Listen. May my beloved come to the garden and eat its choice fruits. Fun. And the man responds. The man responds. I love this. Again, here's what the commentator, the guy that was weirded out by breasts, he says this. The man responds as we would expect him to in light of the woman's invitation. I'm sure that's what he did. Like, that's what happened on my wedding night when Crystal was like, awake my garden. I went, oh, I affirm your decision, and I will now act on it. Like, that is, I mean, like it was, listen, sex is responsive. He is romantic. He is gentle. He is holy. He speaks to her, and she responds. You read chapter 5, verse 1, and he says this. Back to him again. He says, I've come into my garden, my sister, my bride. I have gathered my myrrh with my spice. I have eaten my honeycomb and my honey. I have drunk my wine and my milk. Everything here, did you catch it? Everything is now in the past tense. 9 times before this in Scripture, he calls that garden hers. And now, mine. Love is exchanged. It is given away. And even the community responds here. Many theologians believe that the community's response is actually the voice of God. Then it says, eat, friends, and drink. Drink your fill of love. God is saying, what you're doing is good. Enjoy it. You don't have to wake up with shame that lives in lies. Sex and intimacy, love was never meant to be that. It was meant to be open and free and celebrated and blessed. God is not the enemy of your love life. God is not the enemy of your sex life. He created them both. He is a fan of love. And our culture wants to take certain words and ruin them. Words like purity. Can I just tell you, and I want you to write this down if you've taken notes, purity does not mean sexlessness. Purity is forgiveness. See, there is a continuing ethic to purity that even in my marriage today, I remain pure and undefiled for her. I can be engaged in sex in my marriage and still be pursuing purity at the same time. It is not sexless. It is guiltless. Amazing and free. Do you see here? Like, some of you may be going, like, why are we spending all this time talking about this? I'm going to tell you right now why this is. The Bible will tell us in Ephesians chapter 3 some really powerful words from God. He says, I want you to understand how wide and how deep and how vast the love of God is. And we hear that and we go, I don't understand it. And so in Ephesians 5, the Bible is going to talk to us about what marriage looks like. It is the most comprehensive look at marriage in the Scripture about what it should be like from start to finish. And so in Ephesians chapter 5, at the end of that text, he says, when you get married, you unlock a mystery for the world about Christ and his people. And so what he's saying, that a mystery is not this secret thing. He's saying there's something the world didn't understand that now it can understand. And so you have on one hand in Ephesians 3, there is a love of God that we can't possibly comprehend. And then in Ephesians 5, where God says, I need you to use this relationship to demonstrate for people this thing they can't grasp. It's the reason that at all the marriages that I do, I always start out talking to the people that are going to get married and say, this wedding is not about you. Your sex life is not about you. It is a picture. It is a lens through which we look at and see God. God said in the Old